All right, welcome back from that short break. It is sports this morning, right about now on Abin Today. And definitely, I do have a brand joining me up on this particular one for the latest of what is happening both on the local and international scenes. Good morning to you, Brian.
Morning, Derek. How are you doing?
Very fantastic. It's a bit of a cold Thursday morning, but regardless, we move.
My friend, this rain hit me. I had to fix things up and ultimately make my way here.
Why do you get yourself hit by rain?
I couldn't help it. I don't have a car. I couldn't afford Uber. There was no safe border.
You sound like...
I had to get a random border guy.
You just sound like
me.
Nicholas.
Poverty runs in sports.
Let's talk about some, of course, the latest news coming in as far as, you know, Barara City is concerned. They've been playing their games away from the home grounds, which is Kacheka.
Yeah.
But this time around, you know, FUFA came through to say that now that you have made up to the standards, you'll be having the remaining games, especially the home games at Kacheka Stadium.
That's true. FUFA have come out and confirmed that Barara City, for the rest of the games that they'll be playing in the second round, they can move back to Kacheka. This comes just a couple of days after, you know, they came out to confirm that they pretty much wanted to have this the way they want it to be, because they believe that playing in Kacheka comes with a couple of benefits. First of all, they get to create their home comfort and their home confidence, because they've got the fans at home rooting for them. And then second of all, they create that intimidation, because when teams go down to Kacheka, it becomes very hard for them to pick up a performance. And most importantly, the revenue, they make more money in terms of gate collections, in terms of selling tickets to the fans that come out to watch the game. So tomorrow they'll be taking on Police FC, that is down in Kacheka. But what FUFA have done is that they've given a bit of advice. First of all, they are saying that Kacheka should only host one team. Previously there has been Barara City and then Nyamitobora as well. So for Nyamitobora, they are going to have to find a different stadium or an alternative stadium. And then also on top of that, the number of training sessions happening there have actually been limited, because FUFA believe the lesser the pressure on the playing surface, then the better for it to actually be able to pull off the game. So I think for me it's good news. The fans in Imbara, I know them to be extremely passionate. For the owner of the club, Minem Parker and company, I'm sure they'll be quite ecstatic with the news, because at the beginning of the season, Barara City was one of those teams that was affected by the new change. So let's wait and see, and tomorrow hopefully they get kickoff on a positive note with 3 points at home.
They'll be having a home game?
Yes, tomorrow they'll be playing.
And any news on where Nyamitobora is going to be playing from?
But certainly they'll have to find a smaller pitch, or probably something less fancy than what they've had at the Kacheka in the past.
Can't they, you know, hire maybe one of the school's stadiums? Like, you know, I'll give an example of Ontario or Barra High School.
I think,
or they don't meet the standards that FUFA wants.
First of all, for a stadium to be eligible, it should have an enclosement in terms of a fence. On top of that, there should be dressing rooms. I should actually have stands. There should be a boundary between the playing pitch and where the fans actually get to sit out. So if they can find a facility that has some of these things, then it would actually be a good alternative. I think Torre United did that, because if you remember when they were playing at Buhinga and they actually had to scrap that off, they went for the St. Paul's Seminary Stadium still in Fort Porto. So there's a possibility that they can actually have this fixed. And just like you mentioned, if they can have the right things in place, then they can actually get host their games elsewhere.
All right, let's wait and see how that one gets to unfold. But this time around, we definitely believe that Barara City, commonly known as the Ankole Lions, have no reason for losing out on the home game, bearing in mind that they will have the 12th player, who is the fan that usually comes out in huge numbers. Let's move on and talk about the Rugby Challenger Series. That's definitely around the corner. Coach Tolbert Onyango coming in to make a final 12-man starter team.
Yeah, there is a 12-man team. The Challenger Series will be happening in two countries. One is in Chile, the other is going to be in Uruguay. The first leg will be played between the 15th and the 16th of February. That will be in Chile. And then a week later, they'll be heading out to Uruguay. This is the first time the tournament is happening. And Uganda have been privileged to be one of those African countries that will be playing at the tournament. They are in Pool C, and they'll play against the powerhouses Germany and Italy. They'll also play against Uruguay. If you look at the 12-man squad, there's four players coming through from the club side, that is Cobbs. That is Adrian Casito. There is, you know, Kore. We've got guys like, you know, Ian Munyani and Payas Ogena. And then for the Pirates, they've got three players. That is Desire Ayera, Isaac Massa, and then, you know, that is in Kore as well. And the Heathens have two players, Michael Okorach, certainly one of the bigger names who should be leading out this team. And then Aaron Ofoyerov. You've got guys like, you know, Philip Okorach, who plays his rugby now in France. And Solomon Okya, he's been out for the last couple of months because of that shoulder injury. He's back and he's available. So it's going to be a big opportunity for the team. It also doubles as a qualifier for the Olympics. And I think it's a massive platform and exposure for some of the new names onto the team. So we wish the team the best of luck. And I think it's not going to be easy because when you play against teams like Germany, those are powerhouses in the sport of rugby.
Isn't this going to affect, you know, Philippe Okorachi's games down in France now that he's part of this team?
It does, but it's going to only happen for 2 weeks. So that means that he communicates to the club, he tells them, listen, I need to go and play for my national team. There's this engagement for this period of time. And when it's done, he's actually able to come back and continue playing for them. So it does in a certain way. But I think for both of these players, it's such a big honor and privilege for them to don the national team colors. So when it becomes very hard for you to turn it down. And the beauty about Uganda is that for the Sevens rugby, we've actually been one of the best sides. I think in Africa, we are only behind South Africa. So when it comes to playing this version of the game, I think for most of the players, they're always very excited to be able to play for the national side.
All right, quite interesting. Now, I want us to cross over and go to, you know, China. Now, apparently, we're having, and of course, getting ready for the China Grand Prix as far as the Formula One is concerned. But with the evasion of coronavirus, things could, you know, be turning to, you know, something that we don't expect. The Grand Prix was supposed to happen in April. Now it's, you know, having talks of being pushed. Is this something that is even viable?
That is the big question, because what happens with Formula One right now is that 2020 they've got quite the congested lineup because they'll be having 22 races. The option is that they move it further, but then what the problem would be that the calendar is actually quite fixed towards the end. So there's a big possibility that you could actually see it scrapped off because most of the authorities in China have been meeting. And they've chosen to scrap most of the sports activities in the country. One of those being the, you know, World Indoor Athletics Championships that were happening in China. And it looks like for the Formula One organizers, that is going to be a big question. You know, they are also set to have a meeting and decide whether or not to scrap off the Shanghai Grand Prix, which should be happening in China in April. And that is not the only sports event that will be affected, but the Olympics as well. They happen in between July and August this year. They're arguably the biggest sporting fiesta that brings together all these different sports. And the Olympics as well could actually get affected. And then there is a Grand Prix in Vietnam. They've had about 12 cases also in terms of the coronavirus. So there's considerations that we could also see this one here as well being affected.
The one in Vietnam.
That in Vietnam.
And they are bordering each other. So.
Yes. So I think it leaves us in a very, destabilized situation. And for most of the fans in China, there is lookout for Formula One when it comes around. So when they do not have this one here happening for them, Mitsuri is a massive blow in so many ways.
Do we have instances where we are going to be replacing, you know, this China Grand Prix to, you know, another one? Maybe we can have another city or something, or maybe take it back to Dubai?
There's one in Dubai towards the end, probably if we make it to there. The US has been one of those markets that the Formula One organizers have actually been trying to tap into. I think that would be a good opportunity for them. But the thing about Formula One and organizing a race is that you cannot do it in an instant. In an instant, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of resources. Usually it will actually take you years before you can actually pull off a race. So I think the only viable option would be that they scrap it off and they just do not have it because a lot of efforts and resources are going to pulling off a Grand Prix.
All right, let's wait and see how that one gets to, you know, unfold as far as, you know, the coronavirus is concerned. And what are the chances that in case, you know, by April we have, you know, coronavirus wiped out of, you know, China? Shall we still have the Grand Prix there?
Totally. That would be the best news for the organizers. And they would not even think twice about having it because it has already been scheduled on the calendar. And it's pretty much the virus that is sort of, you know, affecting it. But what happens is for sports events like this, they draw so many people. And given this is an epidemic that is easily spread around, the fear is always that when you have so many people in one place at the same time, it could pretty much go on to go viral. So in the event that it's not there anymore, then Formula One will actually continue to happen.
All right, let's wait and see how that one gets to unfold. But crossing over to, of course, more news coming in from the FA Cup game that was played yesterday. Yeah. We did have Tottenham up against, you know, Southampton. A game that Tottenham did win, of course, after a couple of tries here and there and coming in with a late win.
Late win, two late goals coming through. One, a penalty from Song Heung-min. The other, another beautiful goal from Lucas Moura. Tottenham took the lead quite early in the first half. Jack Stevens converting into the back of his own net after it, you know, a cross from Ndombele. And obviously, you know, Southampton went on fighting and they pulled one back through Shane Long. They took the lead in the second half through Danny Ings, who has arguably been their best player this particular season before those two late goals. So for Tottenham, they head into the winter break having gone into the fifth round. I think it's a big opportunity for Jose Mourinho to pick up a bit of silverware before the end of this season because in the Champions League, they've got a tricky try again. a tricky tie against RB Leipzig. Mm. They're already out of the Carabao Cup. They are sitting fifth in the Premier League. So if there's any possibility that they're going to win some silverware this season, I think for me, the FA Cup is a big opportunity. And he's a guy that knows what it takes to win the cup competitions.
Okay.
So 3-2, I think the biggest undoing is that they've not been able to keep clean sheets at Tottenham. They've been shipping in goals left, right and centre.
Mm.
I think ever since Mourinho came in, they've only kept 3 clean sheets. So the big challenge going into the winter break is going to be how does he get his team to pick up as many clean sheets as possible and also play a better defense, because that has been their undoing in the recent past. But a strong team that he fielded on the day, you could clearly see that there was intention from get-go. So for Tottenham, they joined some of the other big boys that pretty much did progress into the fifth round, which is also the round of 16.
Would you say that, you know, now Jose Mourinho has now mastered his art around the team, and maybe Tottenham could be one of those teams that we definitely need to look out for as far as, you know, different tournaments are concerned?
One of the good things he's done is that he signed in the key areas. First of all, he extended the deal for Giovanni Lo Celso. On top of that, he pretty much went on to add to the attacking options, bringing in Steven Bergwijn from PSV. Obviously, Harry Kane has been the biggest blow for them because he's out until at least late April or early May. And without a key player like that, you struggle to find who scores the goal. So that has been the big undoing for them. But in the midfield, they look quite stable going forward. They also look quite good. And they've got guys like Lucas Moura, Song Heung-min firing down the flanks. So the backline is now the big problem for them. And I think if Mourinho can pick up a cup competition, probably the FA Cup. Interestingly, in England, it's the most prestigious tournament in ahead of the Premier League. So.
It's funny like that, but anyway, but do you think that Tottenham could actually lift this one?
I think they've still got a bit of competition. Teams like Manchester United are still in there. Manchester City have pretty much also taken this one here quite seriously. Teams like Arsenal stay in the running. So all the big boys are still in there. But the thing I know about Mourinho is that he's a tournament coach. He'll come and play for a result and he'll pick it up if he needs to. So.
Okay.
When push comes to shove, he's the kind of guy that you can fancy to get the best out of the team. And I think for me, if he can get the confidence into the boys, then they can actually win it.
All right, let's wait and see how that one also turns around as far as, you know, Jose Mourinho's stay at Tottenham Hotspurs is concerned. Thank you very much, Brian, of course, for coming through. Now, later on at 2:30, we shall be having the women coming through to studio with Sportswoman to give you the latest of what is happening in the world of sports. For now, we're going for a very short break, but when we do get back, we want to find out what is happening on social media as far as the love letter is concerned.